Thank you. Tonight I want to talk about two things. The politics of education and politics and education. It's two distinct and different things. Can you hear me? Okay. First of all, I want to give a little test, though. I know you didn't expect to be tested when you came. But when you hear the word inflation, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? I hear a lot of people say money. Now, that's because you've been trained to think that when you hear the word inflation, you automatically think of money. But to inflate means to blow up. Right? Now, that's somebody who's trained. When a trained person hears the word inflate, he thinks of money. An educated person with cross references hears the word inflate, and he thinks about blowing up. So when people go around talking about inflating things, you know they have more than one meaning. Now, to go to another point, an example, Isaac Hayes is a good example of a cat who's been educated and not trained. He took the song, you know, that he sings, "By the Time I Get to Phoenix." People thought that, you know, everything that could be possibly be done to that song had been done. Until my man took it and turned it all the way around. He was an educated person. See, a trained person operates on the basis of no cross references. In other words, you cannot apply cross references. An educated person can apply cross references. Now, with this in mind, when we began to look at the type of system, see, that America allows through her education and through her training as a fact, you find out that the whole mobility for cross references has been limited and almost eliminated as far as black people are concerned and oppressed people in this country. Politics, we have to have a reevaluation of politics. See, we've been taught to think that when the word politics is mentioned, as we're talking about Democratic and Republican Party. That's not the case. See, politics concerns everything that you do. Everything that happens in your life is political. The real question is, whose political end does it serve? If it does not serve your political end, then it is not beneficial for you to be political in that fashion. Now, the problem, again, back to the whole thing of politics, the politics of education in this country. The problem with Negro was not the word itself. It was that a stereotype had been attached to that word Negro, and that people were forced to live in accordance to that stereotype. In other words, you know, Negroes lived in constant fear of being, you know, like proven not sufficiently trained. In other words, if you split a verb in front of a blood a few years ago, it was a Negro, you split a verb, and that cat almost died for you. Because what you were doing, you were reflecting that you were not trained. Not educated, that you were not trained. You see, and some of the most, you know, like so-called intelligent, some of the most educated people in the country are the most unintelligent people in the country. A good example would be Nixon, Johnson, all of these people with college degrees. Now, they have educated their education, they're trained, but they are unintelligent also. So that shows you that the type of education that's given in the country, the type of training, which is really training, that's given in the country, has very little to do with the intelligence of a person. Now, students, for an example, you see, your students, either by accident or coincidence. But you're black, and that's a fact. You're oppressed, and that's a fact. And to deal with the reality of that oppression, you must begin to look at your situation as students, secondary, and as being oppressed first. And the skills that you acquire as a result of being education, how can we utilize those skills to eliminate that oppression? That becomes the question for students. Again, when you begin to understand the whole system of education in this country, see, whatever you don't control can be used as a weapon against you. Anything that you don't control can be used as a weapon against you. Education has been used as a weapon against black people because black people have been trained to think a certain way. See, we do not control politics, so politics as it's known in this country is a weapon against black people. And we began to examine what politics is. We find out it's no more than the apex of white cultural aggression. Nothing more. When a man tells you that you can only become free through voting, then he is restricting your mobility. He's restricting your freedom. You were born free. You must exercise your rights to be free. See, that man cannot give you freedom. But when he restricts an individual and tells him that he can only become free by voting, then he has denied you your freedoms. He says, this is politics. The only way you can become free is by being political in the white sense or in the sense of this country. But politics in this country, you see, the whole thing, it refers again back to what Camus once raised. He says, what better way to enslave a man than give him the vote and call him free? Does black people absolutely no good to be able to vote unless we can choose who we're voting for? Then when it goes down and you begin to dwell and look farther up into the political system of this country, you find out that there is no political party that's anti-property. So where do we fit in? Whether that property is us, or whether that property is land, or whether that property is a Cadillac, or whether that property is a credit card. No party in this country is anti-private property, anti-gain, personal gain, no party. So where does black people and oppressed people fit in into a political system like that? That tells us that we must begin to reevaluate the whole connotation that's been given to politics in this country. See, politics does not mean the Republican and Democratic Party. Politics does not mean the city and state government. Politics goes into something much further beyond that. Politics goes into what happens to your life every day. You see, it's a political decision that most black people in Harlem are junkies. That's a political decision. It's a political decision that black people were forced to be athletes. That's a political decision. It's a political decision that black people cannot occupy offices, high offices in this country as they are called. That's a political decision. But note here, not that, you know, that would make any difference in terms of the whole thing of black people occupying offices. Because when you begin to understand the type of system that operates in this country, then you understand that it's not the individual who manipulates the system. It's the system who manipulates that individual. See, if Cleaver or Dick Gregory had become president in this country, it would make absolutely no difference. Because America would still be in the war in Vietnam. Because the country operates off what's known as the military-industrial complex, which says that war is profitable. Which says that USS Steel must make steel for tanks, because over 70% of the people employed in this country are either directly or indirectly employed by the military. That's the politics of the economy of this country. When oppressed people began to evaluate politics, we must understand that we have to create a politics that's relevant to us. We must create a politics that's relevant to our lifestyle. We must create a politics that's relevant to what we do every day. So when we talk about politics, when we talk about the political reality of the black community, we are talking about something that's beyond Democratic and Republican Party. And in that sense, we must understand that we must incorporate a revolutionary ideology that pushes this type of political know-how and political knowledge in the black community. I want to talk about, you know, that ideology at this point. And it has to be an ideology of revolutionary nationalism. See, this country fosters the idea of competitive individualism. In other words, you know, like, he divides people. He divides. He tells you, be an individual, do your own thing. You cannot do your own thing if your own thing is not the right thing. You cannot do your own thing. You have to understand, one of the most counter-revolutionary things that came out last year was the whole slogan of do your own thing. This is what black people have been doing for years. Now, if your own thing does not happen to be the thing that's right for the struggle, then it's incorrect. You can't do your own thing. See, people run around here talking about, I'm going to do my own here. The junkie is standing on the corner nod and say, I let you do your thing, let me do my thing. You have to understand that we must begin to talk about building a nation. We exist as a nation. The reason they kill black people are not because they exist as wealthy or poor individuals. They kill them because they're black. So what you have to understand is that whether we recognize it or not, we constitute a nation. We must begin to employ nationalism in our struggle. Nationalism merely says that, you know, we're talking about usness or we-ness. Black people can no longer talk about I. See, that whole individual thing has to be thrown out. This is, you know, what one thing that college students have to understand, because most of the cats who come down talking about, I got my stuff together, is cats who are coming out of college. You have to understand that, you know, you, if you're speaking, you have to be speaking for the struggle. You cannot be talking for yourself, because I know what's going to happen if you get caught out there by yourself. You're going to be looking for everybody else at that point. The whole thing of, you know, like collectivism, the whole thing that's not pushed in this country, if you understand again the politics of the country, then you understand why it is not pushed. You understand why America finds it profitable, in her sense, to push the whole thing of individualism. It's the whole rule of divide and conquer, when as America, the patriots of America, do not exist as individuals. In reality, white people in this country do not exist as individuals. See, the police have a line talking about, well, we are a minority too. That's not true, because they reflect the attitude of the majority of the people in this country. And white people, the white people who are racist, the white people, you know, who are capitalists and who oppress people, they reflect the attitude of the majority in this country. So they do not exist as individuals. So black people have to understand that whole thing of individualism is a luxury that we can ill afford. We cannot afford to be individuals in this country. We do not exist as individuals in this country. We must begin to hammer out an ideology of revolutionary nationalism that says that every group, black people, should be nationalists. Puerto Ricans should be nationalists. You know, like white people should be humane, nothing else. Because we cannot talk about white nationalism in this country at this point because of the way it's defined and what it means. We have to talk about white people being humane, nothing else. The American Indian can talk about nationalism. And when all of these groups, you know, began to launch the type of revolutionary nationalism in their country, in their communities, when they become nationalists, then we can talk about waging a people's struggle. We cannot talk about waging a people's struggle in this country before then. Before each individual group becomes nationalistic in the sense that they are organized and that they are together for their own purpose. And that purpose, you know, in the end result will be ending of repression and oppression of the masses of people. Then and only then can you talk about grouping and launching a people's struggle in this country. Now, the whole thing of politics in this country is that the politics plays upon the individual. And one of the mistakes of the movement has been that we have been a victim of that whole thing of the individual. See, the man always points out an individual and he tells you that's your leader. He says that's your leader. Well, you have to examine what he's doing. When he pushes a guy out there and says that that's your leader, he also understands that he can pull that cat in. He can destroy that cat when he gets ready. See, we must begin to relate to concepts, not individuals. See, don't ask me, you know, like, what's wrong with Carmichael and the Panthers? Understand what they both are saying. If you understand the ideology that they're pushing, that's sufficient. Then you take a side on that ideology. Don't take a side on the personalities. So you got to understand the difference. You have to understand the difference between concepts and personalities. See, the man, he found out it's very easy to destroy an individual or to discredit an individual, but it's much more difficult to discredit a concept or an idea. So what he does is that he pushes individuals out. He tells you, this is your leader. Black people will decide when they need leaders, and they will decide who their leaders are. At this point, our job becomes, those people who understand the nature of the struggle, our job becomes to organize black people, to organize for revolutionary struggle, not to be projected as leaders. And at this point, the only force in the black community that will be able to wield the revolutionary ideology will be a political party. A party that pushes that ideology, some type of apparatus that speaks to black people. Because if you don't have an apparatus, if you don't develop alternatives for people, then the people are shuttled right back into the system. And you say, well, you know, we ain't making no progress. See, the role of the vanguard in any revolutionary struggle is to lead. When it ceases to lead, it ceases to be the vanguard. The vanguard is no more than the guardians of the struggle. And people have to understand, people with certain skills, that's your role, students, that's your role. You have to occupy the vanguard position in the struggle because you have certain skills, because you can do certain things. You cannot divorce yourself from that community. You cannot set your college apart from the community that you came from. See, down south, what happens down south in black universities is that when they build a black university, there's usually a physical boundary. It's a railroad track or a lake or something that separates that black university from black community. And so what happens is automatically black students begin to assume that they're different from the people on the other side of the tracks. So all of a sudden they get scared to go out there where they got to buy their wine, because that's all they're going across for. They get scared to go out there because they think it's an entirely different person on the other side of the track. Again, the man is divided. He's made black people think that they're different. That's again, that's a luxury we can't afford. You have to understand in terms of how the man moves, how oppression comes down. He stratifies the community. You examine what happened in terms of the Jews in Germany. He didn't just vamp on the Jews. He got them segment by segment, in other words. The rich Jews say, well, he ain't gonna mess with us. He just getting them poor Jews, them troublemakers. The same thing happens here in the black community. During the rebellion, black people who were doctors and who were professionals said, well, they ain't gonna mess with us. They just getting the lawbreakers. But what really happened was that one of them doctors got caught out there in Newark, and the cop whooped his head till it rope like okra. Then he started talking about we and us. See, but that's the nature of repression. Repression tends to force people together. And it becomes a question as to whether the vanguard can afford to wait till repression forces them together. Given that, you know, a lot of people, the masses of people, even say, will be forced together as a result of repression, the question then becomes, can the vanguard afford to wait until repression forces them together? See, if we are correct in our assumption that the man is coming down every day against black people, then where does that leave us? If he has a timetable, if he operates off that timetable, is it the role of the vanguard to sit back and let that timetable expire, or is it the role of the vanguard to offset the timetable? This is a question that students, again, people who should be occupying vanguard roles in the struggle because of the skills that they have, nothing else. Because of the skills. You have certain skills that can be utilized. Students should be organizing welfare mothers. Students should be organizing young schools. You should be educating kids who are being trained every day. You should be educating. So you have to see your role because you have certain skills. You see, a revolutionary is not only a person who shoots a gun. See, I think a lot of times we've overemphasized the role of the gun in revolutionary struggle. A revolutionary is not only the person who shoots a gun. A revolutionary functions in the struggle on whatever level he happens to be. See, there's something that's going on out at the IBM plant. Somebody's out there sabotaging the machines. They don't know who it is. Could be Leroy Double O Soul Buckwheat Johnson Jr. They don't know what's going on, but they know that their machines are breaking down. He's committing a revolutionary act against that company. So wherever you exist, you can exist in a revolutionary fashion if you are committed to revolutionary struggle. See, it's no longer adequate for us to say that we're going to have revolution by any means necessary. You have to begin to define the means that are necessary. You can't say struggle by any means necessary, because again, you're allowing cats to do their own thing. You allow a cat to say, well, you know, I'm fighting a revolution in this way, Jack. I'm going to get some of the mad money. And that's how I'm fighting the revolution. You must lay down guidelines for revolutionary struggle. And to do that, you must have a revolutionary ideology. People have to understand that in terms of ideology, ideology is shaped as a result of struggle. You don't just sit up one night and come up with the correct ideology. That ideology happens as a result of struggle, of being out there working with people. See, the mistakes that a lot of black people make in terms of going to the black community is that you go in there with a program. Go in with an ideology and work around the programs that exist. Don't go in there with a program. People got a program. They got to have a program to live every day down there. But go in there with an ideology that can tell that cat, I can make, you know, this a little easier on you. We have a revolutionary ideology that tells, you know, in terms of the cat who hustles, that, you know, if you do such and such a thing, you can, you know, in terms of alleviating the pressure and the oppression on other brothers, this can be done. Don't go in there and tell the brother, look here, man, put down your hustling, you know, give up your numbers, What do you have to offer him? Infuse in his mind, how can he use the money that he gets? You know, we need a cut of the money from the numbers to run a revolutionary organization. Then look here, brother, this is what I want to talk to you about. I want to talk to you about, you know, giving me a cut of the money that you're getting from the numbers. That's your revolutionary duty. That's your revolutionary obligation and your revolutionary duty. Don't go there and tell the cat, look here, man, you got to give up that stuff. Because I got something better. Oh, it might be better. It might, but you're telling that cat to give up something that, you know, the way he knows how to live. That's his skill. For a program that he has never tried. For a program that you don't know if it's going to work. See, because most of our programs is theory at this point. The application of theory is the proof of theory. When we begin to apply that theory, when we can tell a cat that we got something that'll work, that's when, you know, cats will begin to come on. Until then, we have to use people on the level where they exist. We can't tell a cat, look at here, man. I mean, I don't, you know, don't go to the wall unless we got an alternative for it. What alternative do you have for a cat who you don't let go to the wall? You either make him aware that he's going to spend some time in jail and you prepare him for that. But to tell him, you know, just, hey, man, don't go to the wall. The cat's going to look at you and say, well, what you got better? What, you know, what you got to offer me, man? I might be able to go to the wall and become a typist. What do you have better to offer me? See, programs exist in the black community. What we have to do is to forge a revolutionary ideology that makes those programs work for the struggle. Make the programs work for the struggle. Now, in terms of the whole role of college students at this point, black college students in particular, you have, you know, a vast, you know, there's a colony in Bedford-Stuyvesant, there's a colony in Harlem, you're surrounded by them. We need people, you know, to do work, to organize black people. We need people to go in and to work with black people, to infuse black people with that type of revolutionary ideology. Because if they don't have it, then every time Nixon comes up and screams that he got a new program, black capitalism, which is, you know, a myth, then they're going to try it out. They're going to go for the ghost. You go for the ghost. You know, you laugh, but you go for the ghost. See, the whole thing, you know, like in terms of where we are at now, where a lot of us are at now, is that we have infused as an ideology, or for an ideology, the whole concept of militant blackism. In other words, it has become sufficient for a lot of us to be black and proud. But understand that there is no contradiction between singing America is my home and saying that I'm black and I'm proud. There is no contradiction. So a lot of us are just at the point where we are black and proud. That's not sufficient. We must go beyond our dashikis, our beards, and our beads. You have to go beyond that. See, because you have to understand that what happens in terms of a country of this nature is that you cannot talk about creating something until this thing has been destroyed. An old principle, the first principle of physical science, says that two objects cannot occupy the same space at the same time. So you cannot build where something exists. You cannot talk about building where something exists. And a lot of us are just at the point where, you know, like, we in our dashiki bags. But understand, you have to go beyond that. What you gonna do if the man come to your house and you ain't got nothing but a dashiki? You gonna beat him off with a dashiki? Are you gonna butt him with your natural? So that says to be black does not ensure survival. Just because I'm black does not mean that I will survive what this man has to put down. So we have to be, you know, aware of that whole thing, that blackism is not an ideology. And people can be black and be individuals. A whole lot of dudes who were screaming that they were Negroes are now black and still doing the same thing. So we have to go beyond that whole concept of just, you know, the natural and the dashiki. Because, you know, if you look at in terms of, you can really gauge the tenor of the country by the way they program you over the idiot box. In terms of the TV thing. Okay, you used to have I Spy, which was an extension of the Long Ranger. It was a logical extension for the Long Ranger. I mean, my man was Tonto, nothing else. Tonto. But then you look today, what you have on TV today, and on the radio, you got the dude in the blue dashiki, the Newport dude in the blue dashiki. on the radio, commercials. I mean, this reflects an air of militancy. This is a whole new thing. White folks will co-opt dog shit, man, if it's to their advantage. If that's to their advantage, they will co-opt it. The militant black, they found it necessary to co-opt that to make it harmless. So they will show you the militant black. They show you a dude on TV. This dude, look at, he can't do wrong right. This cat can't do wrong right. But he's a militant. He a militant. He's standing, he got on all his uniform. He got on his uniform and everything. He's talking bad. He whooping. But in the end, whose side does he come over to? He said, well, yeah, this is my country, baby. And, yeah, you know, and I was going the wrong direction. I mean, the man programs. He programs. He's always wheeling and dealing, man. And you have to understand that the way he trains people. See, he trains people. He trains you to act a certain way. He will train you to be good black niggers. Because he has conceded blackness. The first political victory that black people won in this country was the fact that they said that we are black. They established the fact that, you know, we will not be recognized as Negroes, we are black. The man said, wow, Jim, you know, okay. He said, you know, we'll concede that. We concede blackness to you. But we will not concede revolutionary struggle. We will not concede revolutionary nationalism. We'll concede blackness. Because then he still can sell that program about, you know, like the whole thing of integrating. The whole thing of blacks integrating with whites. He just changed the word. He quit saying Negroes integrate with whites. Now he says blacks integrate with whites. So you have to understand that he's just using black people. He's not using black people to speak the language of black people. He's just putting people in to mimic his language. Just new faces. It's the same old game. Just new faces. That's all a new color. You have to understand that the whole thing of incorporating and developing and forging an ideology is very important when you begin to deal with the masses of people, especially the vanguard, people who are the vanguard, people who will begin to articulate and people who will begin to supposedly educate the masses of people. You have to understand that what's necessary is an ideology that goes beyond that whole thing of, you know, like just physical state of blackness. Because what we are talking about is surviving in this country. That's the whole thing. We have to survive in this country. See, this country oppresses people around the world. It's not just here. It's not just in Vietnam. It's just in Latin America. It's in Africa. It's all around the world. So if people became, but we, you know, we as individuals, we as black people hold the key to liberation of people around the world. See, if people in Vietnam were to become free tomorrow, that would not affect the freedom of people in North Korea. That would not affect the freedom of people in Puerto Rico. See, it's just like an octopus, you cut off his tentacles. He's still got tentacles in other places. But if black people see themselves as being a colony in the eye of the monster, we got his brain. You destroy his brain. And you freed Vietnam, you freed, you know, Africa, you freed Rhodesia, you freed Latin America. Because this man is the chief oppressor of mankind. You have to understand that in terms of his wealth is made through the oppression of people around the world. So when we talk about, you know, like replacing the man, when we talk about an ideology that's limited in scope, that does not talk about destroying the system, a system that demands exploitation, then we are talking about replacing the man. Whenever we talk about, you know, like, well, I don't want to destroy, you know, like this country, then you're talking about replacing. See, I'm as much against a black cat oppressing people around the world as I am a white cat oppressing people around the world. Wouldn't make me any difference. I would struggle just as hard against a black cat who oppressed black people because it would be necessary to oppress some people in this country if you took the seats. If all the white folks in the world were to die and black folks moved in on those in the seats and assumed those positions and business went on as usual, then Vietnam would continue. Rhodesia would still be imprisoned and oppressed. And it would be because of the, you know, the economic pursuits of this country. The only way that this country can stay wealthy is that it oppresses people. Capitalism demands exploitation in some form of other people. So when we're talking about creating an ideology, we have to talk about the ideology that's free from that type of economic oppression and physical oppression, because the physical oppression comes as a result of that economic pursuit. So we have to talk about, you have to begin to examine, we can't be immune. We have to examine all ideologies. We just can't be immune because the man says, well, you know, that's communism. Or that's socialism. You shouldn't talk about that. See, I mean, if this is the role of the student. You have to begin to articulate that. And I'm not saying that, you know, you take a struggle and bring it over here intact. I'm not saying that. Because you cannot import and export revolution. What I'm saying is begin to examine the concepts of socialism. Understand what the man means when he says that the entire wealth of the world belongs to all people. Which again goes back to what American politics is not based upon. Because American politics is based upon property and land. And a question that has to be raised at this point is how can you own land? See, if white folks could figure out how to bottle air, they'll do it to make profit off of it. If they could figure out how to bottle air, they would bottle air. They could figure out how, you know, to measure water in cubics and issue out water every day, they would do that because they could make profit off of that. So you have to understand that how in the world can people, you know, talk about owning land, water, and air, because land is just like water and air in that sense. We have to talk about using the modes of production, the technology. We're not talking about destroying the technology because technology is not an evil in itself. It's how that technology is employed, how that technology is used. We're talking about seizing that technology and using it to benefit mankind, not to oppress mankind. Do you realize that this country is technically capable of feeding people around the world? But they don't even feed black people in the country. Over 500 black kids die each year alone in Alabama for lack of proper food and nourishment. Which again goes back to the politics of this country. And where black people are concerned on that level, that's the politics of genocide. He's exterminating black people actively. He's starving black people to get to death. So we're talking about seizing control of the technology and using it so it benefits mankind, so it benefits all black people. All oppressed people, people around the world. And this is what we have to be concerned about. I'm going to end because I understand that there's some questions, I mean, that people would like to raise. But in ending, I want to say that we have to consider ourselves as the authors of new justice. We have to see ourselves as the authors of a new justice. And wherever we find injustice and tyranny, we must stamp it. We must kill it. Frederick Douglass said, the world belongs to the youth. Our job is to seize that and to make the world more humane. That has to be the role of any revolutionary or any person who considers himself revolutionary.
If we begin to examine the laws that have been coming out, you know, from Washington, D.C., and in terms of local governments, for the past 10 years, these have been laws of repression against black people, directed to black people. Omnibus crime bill, you know, as a new law that come out this summer called preventive detention law, the McCarran Act of 1950, which sets up concentration camps. All of these laws talks about dealing with black people. So I think that, you know, as that type of repression comes down, black people are going to be forced to do certain things. And in terms of, you know, revolutionary people, you see, white folks will create more revolutionary blacks than I ever could.
But when you think that it takes $82 billion to fly up to the moon to bring back some rocks.
I don't think, you know, my burden is any heavier than any other black person's burden in the country. I think what happens is that, you know, what's going to happen to me, it might happen, you know, before it happens to anyone else, but like I always told people about the concentration camps, me and Carmichael can't fill no 20 or 30 concentration camps. They got to be planned on taking somebody else.
Blues ever get you till you didn't know what to do? Have you ever cried the whole night and all of the morning too?
The whole question of alliances is that, you know, I will determine, you know, if I need an ally and if you can serve as an ally. At this point, I don't see anybody in the white community who can serve as an ally because you haven't done any work in your community, the only community that you should be able to relate to. Go talk to the Birchites, and if you can't convince the Birchites, neutralize as many people as you can. Work with as many people who feel the same way as you do. And then if we need you to go gas on yourself and jump on Nixon, then revolutionary act. If we need a revolutionary act and you're a revolutionary, then we determine when that act should be committed. If you're doing it in our behalf, or if you're doing it in your behalf, then you should be moving as a revolutionary anyway.
Life magazine makes it incandescently clear what goes on in rebellion in terms of troops that are sent in. A 12-year-old kid lies dead in the street on the front of Life magazine. He is black. That's part of you laying in that street. I saw a picture of an autopsy of a young 19-year-old kid who had been shot 39 times, four times in the skull with an M1 carbine. It only takes one bullet to kill a man. So he's really telling you something else. He is out to dehumanize black people, and we are allowing him. We are running around talking about black folks are looting. I agree, there should be more shooting than looting. That's the only thing I agree with. Black folks trying to loot when they should be shooting. If you're gonna loot, loot your gun store. Dig it? Brothers, because the only thing he recognizes and respects is armed people. The only reason that the Hokie did not go into Plainfield and wantonly destroy and kill people was because the brothers were armed. They had 46 automatic weapons. Each one of those weapons would shoot 9,000 times and chunk of bricks for half hour. I met a man who said, if I can't get me a gun, he said, I'm gonna fill my flip gun with acid. I saw another brother who said, I got a BB gun, but the BBs are poison. You better arm yourself, brothers. The man is moving to crush black people. The only reason he did not go in there and tap that community was that black people were armed. So he decided to go and have an armistice with these people. They will not be back in that community because white folks don't want to die. That's why they send you to Vietnam. They don't want to die. They want you to die for them. And we've been doing it like fools. For years, we've been running around here talking about love that man to death. You better shoot that man to death. Don't love him to death, brother, because he ain't got no love in his heart for you. When it comes to black people, America has no conscience. I have read where white men have stumped pregnant women in the ground. Black women. They have to show you where his mentality is. He rapes a black woman and then imprisons his son. You've got to be dealing with an animal, brother. One white man said about them, and this was another honky talking about him, Bernard Shaw, says that America has never known civilization. He said it is the only country in the history of the world that has come from barbarism to decadence without going through civilization. And your patriots are. Columbus was a dumb honky. He was the 14th century. Columbus was the 14th century, Joe Louis. He was looking for India. You ever dug where India is on the map? But understand this. America has the power to legitimize anything that happens. They legitimize his stupidity. And they said he discovered a country. How can you discover a country full of people? We also recognize that individuals do not create rebellions. Conditions do. Until they begin to address themselves to those conditions, rebellions will continue and they will escalate. Sometimes the question has been raised about why black men fight and have fought for this country. It is the black man's implacable will to be free that makes him fight for this country. And it is that same will that will make him fight this country. I want to address myself now to problems that exist in the black community across America. And America cannot be considered as a stable and just society. But no stable and just society can mount a successful offensive against black youth who break a window and at the same time plead that it is powerless to protect black youth who are being murdered because they seek to make American democracy a reality. Each time a black church is bombed or burnt, that is violence in our streets. Each time a black body is found in the swamps of Mississippi and Alabama, that is violence in our land. Each time black right workers cannot be protected by the government, that is anarchy. Each time a police officer shoots and kills a black teenager, that is urban crime. You see, we recognize America for what it is, the Fourth Reich. And we tell America to be on notice, because if you are going to play Nazis, black folks ain't going to play Jews. We have to begin to move to control our communities. Everything that's in your community that you don't control is a weapon against you. Public education as it exists today is a weapon against black people. TV and news media, especially the WPP, white power press, white people's paper, and white people's power are enemies against black people. What the white press does is that it makes black people an enemy of black people.